It's time for Windows Weekly. Paul's got the day off, but we've got a great fill-in for him. Travis Lowdermilk of the Windows Developer Show is here. We're going to talk about developing for Windows Phone. We've got a date and maybe even an SDK. Also, the official launch of Windows 8. It's all coming up next on Windows Weekly.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for Windows Weekly is provided by Cachefly at cachefly.com.
This is Windows Weekly with Paul Thorat and Mary Jo Foley. Episode 281, recorded October 4th, 2012. Et tu, Elop? Windows Weekly is brought to you by Go to My PC from Citrix. Go to My PC connects you directly to your Office Mac or PC from any other computer and from your iPad or iPhone, too. Sign up for a 30-day free trial today at gotomypc.com. Use the promo code Windows. And by the new Squarespace. Squarespace introduces a new content management system, making it faster and easier to create a high-quality website, blog, or online portfolio. Plus, more than 50 new features, including mobile responsive designs. For a free trial and 10% off your first purchase, go to squarespace.com and use the offer code Windows10. And by Audible.com. To download the free audiobook of your choice, visit audible.com/windows. It's time for Windows Weekly, the show that covers all your Microsoft needs, whether it's Windows, Windows Server, Hadoop, Windows Phone 6, 7, 8, Surface, whatever you, Xbox, all of that. And today is going to be kind of a developer-focused show because along with Mary Jo Foley, hello, Mary Jo Foley, good to have you.
Hello, Leo.
The regular author of allaboutmicrosoft.com, blogger for ZDNet, and Scooper Deluxe. Because I'm telling you, every time I see a Windows Scoop, always links back to allaboutmicrosoft.com.
Oh, that's good to hear.
No, it's true. I see it over and over again. You are the authority. I could say that because Paul's not here. You are the authority. Paul, where is Paul?
Paul is on a plane somewhere between Colorado and Dedham, Massachusetts.
Oh, dear. Oh, dear. So he's coming home.
Yes.
Yeah. All right. Well, good news because we've got a great sub for Paul. Do you want to introduce Travis Lowdermilk? I think he practically needs no introduction, but...
Oh, I need an introduction.
We'll give him one.
Okay, I'll tell you about Travis Lowdermilk, Yeah. He is the co-host of the Windows Developer Show, formerly the Metro Show, now the Windows Developer Show. Expert on many Windows Phone topics, among other things. And that's why we wanted to have him on today, because we have so much Windows Phone news this week. So we thought he would be a great guest.
Yay.
To have.
Yeah. And Travis and his brother Ryan, of course, have been on the show briefly in the past, saying hello in various venues and things like that. But I don't think you've ever been on the show for the whole episode.
This is a big deal. So let me say hi to Noah, my little boy.
Hi, Daddy's Noah. Are you watching Daddy on the little screen?
Okay, now we can get down to business. I just had to do that.
And I also have to ask, I love Silverlight, really?
Yeah. Come
okay.
on.
Wow.
You gotta love Silverlight. this is starting to become kind of a retro shirt, you know, like
it
when
is.
Things kind of become a fad and now it's cool again to kind of wear things.
Maybe
like
you
this,
could have put a little bar across it, say deprecated or something on it.
Yeah.
It's your deprecated t-shirt.
Yeah. Or maybe say MS hates.
Well, that's the funny thing. Even Microsoft doesn't love Silverlight. So, you're really in a
rare breed.
You're a rare breed. Microsoft did not buy that shirt, sell that shirt. Omega Project in our chat room says, I had one of those shirts. Someone stole my I Love Silverlight shirt from my towel on the beach. So there's now at least three of you who love Silverlight.
I was at a conference and there was a swarm of people, and Microsoft in their brilliant wisdom threw a box of these shirts in the middle of the crowd, and I nearly lost an arm trying to get this thing. So
take them out of the box.
Exactly. They just threw them out there.
That's lazy. Oh, here, have these. Clonk.
Exactly.
One at a time. That's just lazy.
All right. So, let's talk a little bit about Windows Phone because our top story this week, the launch date has been set for Windows 8, Windows Phone 8. I got my invitation for Windows 8 for the Surface launch. That's going to be in New York. It'll be a short party off a long pier or a long party off a short pier. I'm not sure which. You and Paul will be at that, right, Mary Jo?
Yeah, we're going to be there. And then we're going to do some kind of a meetup after that, too.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Now, it's kind of was a shock to me because I don't get invitations, as you know, to events. So I was very pleased. And we had talked about me going out, but I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to probably stay here and we'll do some sort of simulcast.
Oh,
now,
nice.
We were thinking it was going to be late at night, but no, it's 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. I'm sorry.
Yeah, so,
is that right? Yeah.
It is. Yeah. It is. That's like the PR launch. But then we think there's going to still be a Midnight Madness thing. The thing is, they haven't confirmed for sure that there will be. And we don't know if the pop-up store in Columbus Circle in Manhattan will be open yet at midnight. So we're not sure how that's going to work. That's still TBD there on that.
I did note that at least one of the pop-up stores, maybe it's the San Francisco one's opening November 2nd.
Oh, it is? That's weird.
Remember we talked about that? Like, why haven't they announced the dates? Well, now we know. Because it's not like for 5 days after the launch.
Well, that's really weird because so many of them are on October 26th. Like the Manhattan store is opening October 26th.
Right.
So that's odd, huh?
Maybe they couldn't get in there. The Halloween store hadn't cleaned up yet or something. You know.
The closest store to me is Glendale and San Francisco, so I'm going to have to hop in the car. Maybe we should go together, Leo. We'll
all
go
right.
to the San Francisco one.
I really want to get a Surface. Could I order a Surface today if I really, if I showed such an interest? No.
Well, if you're a Steven Sinofsky, you could, but other than
only Steven. Steven, exactly. I bet Steven has one already. But
I think he's got a few.
He does.
we have, courtesy of Rev in our chat room, we have the countdown. It's almost Surface release day. 21 days, 10 hours, 10 minutes, 25, 24, 23, 22 seconds. The countdown is going. Thank you, Rev, for setting that up. So I'll just put that right on the wall. I'm actually a little excited. Now, this Surface will be the RT version.
Right.
We won't get
so that's the ARM-based one that won't run many existing Windows apps, except for Office and Internet Explorer, pretty much. And Notepad. Sorry. Don't forget Notepad. My favorite processor.
But to get back, Windows Phone 8 will then be launched a couple of days late, 3 days later. Will they have a launch event for that as well? Have we seen invitations for that?
Yes, we just got our invites like a few minutes before we started the show. And it's going to be in San Francisco.
What?
Yep.
So now I remember, and Paul have a difficult agenda because you've got to go to Build in Redmond, right? And then there's a Petten Media event in Las Vegas. Can you squeeze this Windows Phone 8 launch in?
Yeah. So here's what I'm going to do. This is my own crazy schedule that week. I'm flying from the New York launch to San Francisco, from San Francisco to Seattle, and then Seattle to Las Vegas the Petten.
Holy cow.
In a span of a week.
Wow.
Yeah.
So what have they revealed in the invitation? Anything?
The invitation has some beautiful Victorian homes from San Francisco.
Alamo Square. That's Alamo Square.
Is that okay?
The Painted Ladies.
Yes.
Yeah. You'd recognize it from what was the TV show that began when they were, it was Full House. You'd recognize it from the TV. Stars.
So somehow Bob Saget's going to be involved. Bob is what you're suggesting.
You know what?
Okay.
I bet he is.
That would be huge. That would be a big development.
I bet he is.
Wow.
What else we know? We know starts at 10 a.m. somewhere in San Francisco. That's all we know.
No location yet.
No.
But maybe it'll be on Alamo Square. I don't know. Interesting. So the Victorian houses. Oh. And apparently, the good news for developers who'd like to write software and have it available the day of the launch, the SDK comes out that day as well.
Yes.
So you could really work
better.
Fast.
It better come out.
Oh, it's not confirmed? That's just a rumor?
I believe so. Yeah, I haven't seen anything unless Mary Jo has something to the contrary.
You know what they said? So when they postponed the availability of the public SDK, when they announced that a couple weeks ago, they said the SDK now will be out for all developers when we launch. So I'm thinking this means October 29th. This is the launch, right?
Yeah, and to be clear, Microsoft has already started seeding out the SDK to specific developers.
Oh, good.
There's a bit of an application process involved, okay. Which you know some folks don't like because it kind of introduces favoritism and that sort of thing, or at least the perception of favoritism. So I think Microsoft's being a little bit more careful because with this particular SDK, there's a lot more integration with the OS that they haven't talked about yet. And so they want to make sure they get that in developers' hands so they can take advantage of it, but not lift the entire kimono, if you will. So I kind of go back and forth. I mean, I get why they're trying to do that. I understand why developers are upset. But I think in all reality, you know, if you have a legitimate app that needs to be ready for day one and you can kind of make that case, I don't see why you wouldn't be able to get the SDK. For the most of us, you know, I can sit here and complain, but I know full well what I'm going to do. I'm going to download the SDK, play around with the emulator, and then go back to work.
Right.
So,
right.
So I don't know. I don't know how
so
much
outrage. You don't have the SDK, Travis?
No, I don't. No. I never really applied. And frankly, to be completely honest, and this is going to totally kill my developer cred, I'm not currently working on a Windows Phone app. So, I really didn't have anything to kind of submit and you know, say, hey, can I get the SDK anyway? So I'll sit tight with everybody else and we'll wait and see.
Mm-hmm. Is this a problem that, I mean, I'm sure, you know, Evernote has the SDK. Netflix has the SDK.
Yeah.
The big apps have the, Twitter has the SDK. But well, it I means mean, there'll be a limited number of apps available.
Yeah, and I mean, you've always said that it's all about having the right apps,
the big apps
right?
Yeah. So,
and I'm a firm believer in that as well. At least as far as you know, making a platform successful. Now, being a developer, with that said, you know, there has to be access for us to you know to the tools and the tool set in order for us to participate as well. Because you know, the next Angry Birds, if you will, is going to be coming from you know folks like us right. who right. dream up these ideas and so on.
Is
and so
the
forth.
Developer but, community? Unhappy about this at this point?
It depends on how you ask. You know, I think for the most part, there is a little bit of, I would say they're perturbed. I wouldn't say there's outrage. At least that's been
my
experience.
Let me answer that. Let me throw my two cents in there. Yeah. They're really, really mad. I think you're being diplomatic. I'm trying to be diplomatic.
Well, it puts them at a disadvantage for sure because they won't be able to get something out for a while.
Yeah, so existing Windows Phone apps can run on Windows right. Phone 8, Microsoft has said, right?
So okay, we'll so have Windows Phone 7 apps are all going to be fine. And are they going to run fine, work fine, look normal, be as good as, be peers to a Windows Phone 8 app?
I think largely, yes. Aside from you know some of the new features that might be available, the trick is we haven't officially seen all the consumer bits that are coming with Windows Phone
right.
8. So there is a possibility that there's some feature that's available and we go, well, you know, why doesn't my app support that?
Yeah.
And there could be some backlash that way. But
consumers, then it sounds like, I mean, you know, it's one thing if the app is like, has borders around it or something. Or, you know, when the iPhone Retina came out,
exactly.
Original iPhone apps looked terrible on it or the iPad, but that if as long as it kind of hey it runs the same as it did on Windows Phone 7, it's exactly the same. It doesn't feel like a second class citizen. The average user is not going to say, "Well, where is feature X?" That they're just going to say, "Oh, good, my apps are here." And there will be what is how many 10,000 apps available day of the or more, right?
More than 100,000.
Yeah, 100,000. Is it that many?
Yeah.
Wow. All right. Yeah. So yeah, that's I mean, not the, so the, bad.
Yeah. The thing people complain about is, you know, if you want to code to the new features that are in Windows Phone 8 that aren't in Windows Phone 7, like want to take advantage of the wallet or multi-core mm-hmm. chips or NFC, those are what you can't do yet unless you have one of these private builds of the SDK.
Yeah.
And I understand if you're a developer that maybe, you know, you'd feel a slight disadvantage, but you'll just upgrade down the road. I think this is a concern for developers of existing apps maybe more than anybody. And for consumers, it doesn't really. I can't see why it would matter. Unless, Ryan, you think there's some magic feature that's going to be so hot in Windows Phone 8.
I think the NFC stuff certainly has a potential to do that. So some it'd be very interesting to see what developers do with that. And but I got to imagine that Microsoft's already working with those developers that have significant plans on how to introduce something like an NFC. You know, they're not going to launch the device and say, okay, NFC is available. Now everybody go build something. So I think there's going to be a story for some of those apps. But, you know, when you're an independent developer and you're trying to do this on your own, it can be frustrating because you feel like, well, I don't have the power of, let's say, I don't know, Citibank or Visa or something like that to go in there and have these special relationships. So I totally get it. I mean, I get the outrage.
I'm just thinking it's not it's whether it's going to hurt Microsoft from the user, the consumer's point of view. It doesn't sound like it's going to. Will all the Microsoft Windows 8 phones have NFC? Is that kind of a guaranteed?
I believe so. Isn't it a part of the spec?
It's on the spec. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Isn't that interesting? This is something Apple did not choose to do in the iPhone 5. Yeah. And pretty much all other smartphone platforms will have it.
Hmm. Yeah, but you got to do it, you know, kind of correctly, right? So yeah. It's one thing to support the hardware, but, you know, as the ecosystem there, I think Microsoft has a good track record, right? I mean, they're a partner-focused company. They certainly have the ability to partner with, Visa and these types of companies to have a purchasing plan. But, you know, NFC often is lauded as being, oh, you know, pay with your phone type thing. And there's so many other use case scenarios that could be used with NFC. And Microsoft's already starting to show some of that off with their tablets and their phones connecting and, you know, tapping the devices together and having all these kind of unique application scenarios. So I think I'm really excited to see what our developer community is going to do with NFC. I think that we're going to start to see some kind of interesting, innovative ways that people go, oh, okay, it's more than just about, you know, purchasing something at CVS or a pharmacy or something like that.
Yeah. So while I understand, Mary Jo, the anger if you're a developer, you know, an independent developer doesn't have the clout to get in early.
Yeah.
I think I'm thinking just purely from the user point of view. Should users even worry about this or will they won't be aware of it?
No, I don't think they should worry. I think, you know, if Microsoft makes the SDK available to everyone around the 29th, you know, people are going to be coming out with the new apps pretty quickly. And you know, the phones aren't even going to be out on the 29th. We should say bring that up.
Oh.
So Microsoft, Microsoft launches the operating system on the 29th. The phones probably are not available till first week of November and after that.
Oh.
So there's a little window. There's a short window, at least, not a lengthy window. Between the launch and when you can actually get a phone. So there's a little extra time padded in.
Okay. Now, here's the 60.
We're used to waiting, so that's okay.
Well, remember, you represent developers, Mary Jo, enterprise users, developers, but I'm always thinking in terms of the consumer,
sure.
The person who's deciding right now, Galaxy Note 2, iPhone 5, HTC 8X, or a Lumia 920, what should I get? Mm-hmm. And for that person, they're not going to say, well, I'm going to stay away from Windows Phone because the SDK has not shipped yet.
They will say, I'm going to stay away from Windows Phone if insert app isn't
available.
If
Netflix isn't on there, or Audible isn't on there, or Twitter isn't on there, or Foursquare isn't on there. But I've got to think they're all on there. In fact, even, you know, smaller apps, apparently some have already gotten the SDK. So,
yeah.
Fruit Ninja.
I think the only risk I see to, you know, the 3% of us that are users on Windows Phone right now, the 3%, the loyal 3%.
3%.
A lot of those people are the developers of these apps. So you don't want to alienate those of us who've been backing the platform from day one,
yes,
whether we're developers
that's right.
or consumers,
that's
whoever, right?
Yep. That's
Keep
a very
happy.
Good point. Yeah, no, that's a very, very good point.
Yeah, I think if developers don't feel like they have a fighting chance to really be successful and shine on the platform, they're going to walk, right? And so there's always that kind of delicate balance between, you know, being a little bit secretive and kind of seeding this out and trying to keep it close to the vest, but also keeping a rich and vibrant developer community as well so that you have great apps constantly coming to the platform. So
They're
kind of dancing around. This is unique, I think, for Microsoft up to this point of doing this kind of seeding the SDK. They haven't ever done this, or at least that I can recall before. So it doesn't seem to be blowing up completely, but I think that's largely because, again, we're the 3%. So.
Right. Windows Phone 8 from Microsoft.
I know. this is the rumor that will not die.
I don't care.
Making me think maybe it's true.
But do you think people?
Well, they said the tablet was the rumor that wasn't going to die either, and now we have the Surface.
Yeah, so we do have the tablet.
I know.
Will there be a Surface phone?
We don't know.
That would complete the line. And then in June, the Xbox Surface.
That would be awesome.
A touch Xbox.
Yeah. I think there is more coming on Surface, right? Like Microsoft's leaving that very open-ended. Mm-hmm. Like it's not just Surface RT and Surface Pro, these two tablets. There are more things that are going to be branded Surface that are coming. Mm-hmm. We just don't know what these are yet. So, you know, there's been renewed speculation this week. There was a story in the China Times. Boy Genius Report had the rumor. Windows Phone Central had the rumor. They're all saying that there is going to be a Microsoft-made Windows phone. And some of them are saying it could be branded Surface. When we ask Microsoft, they just say, we're coming to launch with our partners, and we really love our partners. But they aren't saying, we're not doing this.
Right.
This is why this rumor keeps coming back and coming back. They won't deny it once and for all. And I think the reason they won't deny it is it probably is a plan B, if not more active than that.
Do we know how they're planning on manufacturing the Surface? Because I think if they were setting up manufacturing plants, that would probably be significantly kind of a tip to us.
Really?
That I think so. If they had their own manufacturing plants, then you could. I mean, because Microsoft's a software company, right? So if they started, you know, building their own manufacturing plants, I think they did that with the Xbox. In I think they have a manufacturing plant in China.
That they might. Do
I think
more.
So. Yeah, and I don't know if they're doing that with the Surface. I think
why
they're partnering.
I think the times have changed now. You just get everything. Get Foxconn to make everything.
Yeah.
Right? Why make anything?
Right. And supposedly Pegatron's the one making the Surface. For
the Surface.
Microsoft.
Okay.
Right.
Yeah.
So okay. even if you're gonna make a phone, the days of manufacturing it yourself are long gone. Don't you think?
Yeah.
So much cheaper. Get hire one of them 50-cent an hour Chinese guys.
Yeah.
Somebody sent me a link before the show. Apparently, let me see if I can find this picture again. This is from Gizmodo. Foxconn has installed a suicide net.
Oh boy.
Oh man.
Over.
That's horrible.
It's depressing. Oh, I mean, over the street, so that their workers will not jump out of, even if they jump, they'll be caught. That's ridiculous. Now, I don't know if this is true or anything, but geez, there are nets. I mean, there's a picture of a net come all the way down to the Foxconn dorms. Maybe people have been throwing, you know, cigarette packs out the window. That's probably what it is.
Yeah, that are iPhones. One of the two.
iPhones. Quick. Here comes,
you know, when I look at the rumors of the Surface phone, part of me, you know, thinks that certainly it would make sense for Microsoft to strategize this way. Clearly, they're doing this with the tablet. My only concern is that I hope they don't get ahead of themselves in the sense and start really focusing on making their own phone. What I'd like to see is them focusing on the Surface tablet. Let's make sure that that's a, you know, gangbuster hit. Really focus on that hardware, you know, maybe even come out with a couple of revisions of it. And get that kind of all figured out. Because, you know, the mobile market's completely different in the sense of, or the mobile phone market, when you have to deal with carriers and contracts and all these kinds of deals, it muddies up the waters with Nokia and everything else. So, I don't know. I would love to see a Microsoft Surface phone, but right now I'm kind of focused on the tablet and wanting that to be successful. I mean, frankly, we don't know. Like, are people going to run out and buy Surface hardware? You know, that's a big unknown. So,
but Microsoft's not denying it.
No.
But that's probably because they're working on it. I think. Anyway. I don't know, but I'm just saying it makes sense that they would.
You know, if the person who most wants Microsoft to deny this is Stephen Elop, who runs Nokia, right? Yeah. Because if you think about it, Nokia is Windows Phone right now. They're the one of the five Windows Phone vendors that are left that is only making Windows phones. Okay, so if you're Microsoft and you say, hey, guess what, guys? We're making our own phone. It's going to be Microsoft branded. It's going to be this thing called Surface. If you're Nokia, you're just like panicking at this point because you're like, oh, man. Like, I thought we were their phone, even though that's not officially the way it's positioned. Mm-hmm. And a couple people interviewed Stephen Elop this week about this, and he said, if they're making their own phone, we don't know about it.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Awkward.
Awkward.
He didn't say, absolutely not. My friends at Microsoft, my former coworkers, the people I do love so much, have told me many times they would never step on Nokia's toes. No, just we don't know anything. It would be that would be kind of a...
Yeah.
Yeah, but I mean, I guess we're experiencing that with the Surface right now, right? I mean, companies like Acer and Asus.
Well, that's why the rumor, right? Is because they screwed the OEMs for desktops. Or did they?
I don't know. Yeah, we go around about this all the time. I'm glad they're making a Surface because I haven't really loved my Windows hardware lately.
Right.
So, yeah, I agree. I mean, Microsoft needs to do this. I think Windows 8 is such a different shift in how consumers are going to use this product that much like how Google does with Nexus, it's important that they have a device that they can control hardware and the whole experience to make sure that at least, you know, bare minimum, they have a flagship device. And I think it's absolutely important that they do it.
Yeah.
Although, you know, what was interesting this week, I had a conversation with a guy. I'm not going to name who this was, but he is a Wall Street analyst and very bullish about Microsoft normally. And he said to me this week,
well, that should narrow it
down. Don't you think the Microsoft Surface tablets could be another Kin?
No,
he said another Zune. He said, you know, like they look really awesome.
Oh, that's better.
Right? Yeah. Still not great,
Still not a Kin, a Zune. Oh, well, at least we got a year or two.
Right. But no, he's like, you know, I think the Zune came, finally, when they got their act together with the Zune HD, awesome piece of hardware, right? But you guys in the bubble there, you Microsoft watchers who think the Surface thing is going to be so awesome, maybe you're the only ones who are going to buy it. And I never even kind of thought of that because I guess I'm so excited to see some different hardware that looks really nice from what we've seen, although none of us have actually tried it yet still. But I was like, wow, what if he's right? Yikes. I didn't think of it that way till now. Actually, I really did not.
Interesting.
It's what keeps me up at night, Mary Jo. This thought
is it?
Right here.
Okay.
Yeah.
Not Noah. It is.
That too. But no, I think what's interesting about the Surface that really hasn't been kind of communicated is that it's really going to change the notion of how people look at tablet devices. I really do believe that. When you have the touch cover and you have the kickstand and all this kind of stuff, I mean, around the office, we all use iPads and it's funny to me when I see folks strap in all these accessories to virtually make them into a laptop.
Yeah.
You know?
I'm much more interested, though, in the Pro version than the RT version.
Oh, I agree.
I like the idea of a computer, a full computer in that form factor. If it's done well, if it doesn't have a fan and things like that, then that's going to be very intriguing. Windows RT, my biggest fear of that is just there's not going to be any apps for it. It's going to feel like a very constrained environment.
Yeah. And we don't know, like, if kind of going back on that app mantra, we don't know if the core apps are going to be there. Facebook, Twitter, Netflix, Hulu, HBO Go, you know, all the apps that people kind of expect, especially on an RT device, which is far more positioned as a consumer kind of consumption device.
Yes.
It's important to have those. Now, I will say that with Windows Phone, when it launched, I think it was like only Mary Jo, you could help me, but maybe like a week or two before Facebook finally came out and said, yeah, we're going to have a Windows Phone app. And there was like this collective sigh of relief because it was like, up to that point, we're thinking, man, you know, are the big players going to be there? And, you know, some might say, well, you know, the Windows experience is integrated, so you don't really need things like Facebook and Twitter, but you definitely need that support of, you know, the major companies saying, no, this is a platform, especially from a developer perspective, because if I see that Facebook didn't take the time to make an app for day one, then I'm not rushing out there either to make sure my app is available. So I have no doubt that Microsoft's working with those people clearly. I mean, it's not like they don't understand that those apps need to be available, but I'd love to start seeing them now if that would be at all possible. I mean, we do have access to the RTM. The store is open. It'd be great to start getting those apps in and saying, hey, no, they're going to be available day one.
Yeah. Ryan,
as of this week, there's 3,600 apps in the store that are Metro style or Windows Store apps. It's ramping up pretty quick because just a few weeks ago, I think there were under 2,000. So it is growing very quickly now that the store is open and all. But yeah, people do want to know that these big apps are going to be there. And I cannot imagine that Microsoft has not seeded the really big, important app companies and gotten them to make sure their apps are out day one. They have to be.
Well, hey, good news. We're going to find out. October 26th. Now, you said the phone won't be available on the 29th. But Surface will be available on the 26th.
Yes.
Yes. And I presume a whole raft of Windows 8 machines.
Right. Like there'll be a variety of Windows 8 tablets, Windows 8 PCs from different vendors. There'll be some Windows RT-based tablets that day, we believe. So that those are the ones that are ARM-based tablets from some of the third-party vendors, too. Mm-hmm. So all of those should be out on October 26th or right shortly after that. Like you're going to see that day, that launch day, there'll be stuff in the stores ready to go, ready, preloaded, ready, all the way. Ready. They've got to be ready.
ready. All right. Ready. Let's take a break. Ryan Lowdermilk is here from the Windows Developers.
I got to stop you, Leo, because you keep calling me Ryan.
Lowdermilk is here.
My brother is never going to let me down if you keep calling me Ryan.
Travis Lowdermilk is here.
He's not calling you Travis Joe. Don't complain too much.
Yeah, Travis Joe. Travis Joe Foley is here.
Actually, that's not such a bad name. We'll take that.
Remember, Travis, you would remember this, that commercial, and was it for Calvin Klein or something, and it was this moody thing in the desert and went on. And at the end, there's only one line, and it is, Travis, your year's too late. Right? Something like that.
I don't know.
You don't remember that?
YouTube it.
Must be before your time. I will YouTube it while we do another commercial. How about that? Not too late for Go to My PC from Citrix. Actually, boy, you know, if you just got back from a trip and you were frustrated because the boss would call and say, hey, I got some, you know, can you send me that PowerPoint? It's on your computer at work. Maybe it was too late. Maybe, but it's not too late if you're hearing this now and you're about to take off from the office. Maybe you want to go home tomorrow. I think everybody should work Fridays at home. It's just obvious, right? 20% less gas used, 20% less wear and tear on your brain. You're in your jammies, you're at home. But the key to this is being able to get to that office computer. That's where all the good stuff is, and that's why GoToMyPC is such a great product. GoToMyPC.com. It's remote access done right now. It's from Citrix, so I know you know the name Citrix. Anybody's a Windows user, especially in business, knows about Citrix. That is the definitive remote access tool. In fact, they invented remote access, licensed it off to Microsoft for RDP. But they've continued to improve it, continue to make it easy to use, and GoToMyPC really is the state of the art, both in speed, but also in convenience. For instance, it uses NAT traversal, so you don't have to put a hole in the firewall, you don't have to open ports. It just works. It uses SSL, so it's always secure. In fact, GoToMyPC is a great way to work securely without a VPN, even from an insecure open access spot. You've got a secure link right back to your office system. You could do anything you could do at work, too. Send and receive email, run any program, access any network resource. Now, here's the nice thing. It works on Macs and PCs, so you can put it on your computer at work, either Mac or PC. And then you can access it from any computer, a Mac, a PC, or an iPhone, an iPad, or an Android tablet. So next time you hit the road, don't bring your laptop. Bring an iPad or an iPhone or an Android tablet. Now you're able to access your Windows or Mac machine and do all of that with this little thing in your pocket. This is very cool. The best way to understand what GoToMyPC can do for you is to visit the website, GoToMyPC.com, and click that orange Try It Free button, and you can use it free for 30 days. When you use the code Windows. Right there it says promo code. Just type WINDOWS. By the way, don't get confused. That doesn't mean you can't install it on a Mac. You can install it on whatever you want. But use the offer code Windows and you'll get 30 days free. It is really the best remote access. Install it on your computer at work, then head out. The apps are free for your Android and iOS devices. And, of course, you can access it from any laptop. Very secure and very easy to use. This is the best remote access. No wonder the reviews, and you can read them all on the site, are so good. Downright addictive, says PC World. One of the slickest, most effective tools out there. GoToMyPC.com. Use the offer code Windows. Travis Lowdermilk, Mary Jo Foley. Paul's got the day off. We're talking Windows Phone, Windows 8. We're talking Surface. We're talking Lumia 920. There's good news and there's bad news. The good news for you, Mary Jo, is cyan. Are you happy?
Yeah.
So that is the most lukewarm. Yeah. Yeah. Is it because it's not on Verizon? Do you want Verizon? Is that what you want?
It's not going to be on Verizon. The Lumia 920 is exclusive to AT&T. We knew that was going to happen. No, we didn't. I almost didn't wear my headphones from Nokia today in protest. I was so mad.
But come on, really, honestly. It's not Nokia's fault. It's Verizon's fault.
Well, isn't it? We don't know.
Verizon, no love for Windows Phone. I mean, they had the Hero. That's it.
Yeah, but this time around, it's going to be different, they say.
Yeah.
This time around, Verizon says multiple models, right? From different handset makers.
Do we know now you like the HTC 8X, though. Is Verizon
that is going to be on Verizon. So I'm not totally bummed.
And you can.
I wanted a choice.
Oh. Okay. Well, let's not ask for the world here.
Actually, I think it's Microsoft's problem. It's not Verizon's problem. Microsoft has to work with Verizon and make sure that they put their devices right where they need to be, right? I'm still befuddled by this kind of partnership, premier partner, whatever you want to call it, that they have with AT&T. I thought they did abysmal when Windows Phone initially came out. They improved that much better when the Lumia 900 came out. You could actually go into AT&T stores and the workers were actually holding the devices and using them. They were far more knowledgeable about the Windows Phone platform than they were previously. So hopefully they're going to continue on in that vein. But, you know, all these exclusivities, it gets really, really frustrating. The bottom line is that Verizon and Sprint does not still, to this day, have a decent flagship Windows Phone, and that's a significant problem. My mother-in-law, who has a HTC Trophy just like Mary Jo does, this thing's on the fritz, and she's calling me constantly saying, you know, should I just go ahead and get an iPhone, or, you know, I like my Windows Phone, I want to keep it, but I don't want this same phone. So it's like, and I have to, you know, assure her, you know, no, it's coming. They said that they're going to have, you know, more devices to choose from. I do believe that Verizon is going to get serious about Windows Phone. I would expect, if I had to guess, I could easily see them having one, two, probably even three devices by holiday season. I think it's going to happen.
So this doesn't mean they're not going to get. What does it mean?
What we don't know, right? Is there another Nokia model that's somewhat comparable to the 920, like a 922 or whatever, like this rumored 922? Is that going to come to Verizon? So if that does, then yeah, no big deal, right? Unless AT&T has a three-month exclusive on this. Then if that happens, it means Verizon won't have a Nokia flagship device in time for holiday. So again, you're like, right? Because a lot of people buy smartphones for holiday gifts, don't they?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And you got to figure a lot of folks' contracts are up that bought the Windows Phone originally at launch. That was around October, November. So we're all due up and ready to purchase our next phone. So.
Is it possible that it is Nokia's fault they don't make a CDMA Lumia?
I think it's Verizon's fault for using CDMA. How about that?
Nokia is a global operation that wants to sell GSM phones. It's GSM everywhere except a few countries. Verizon is CDMA.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's the continual
story. Could it just
story.
Be that?
I wonder. You know what? No one has asked that to you, Leo. You asked the good question. And that is a good question. I can't remember.
Well, it was the same problem with the iPhone, right? When, you know, and that's why it was on AT&T
was
for
GSM
so long.
Because they... Well, yeah, actually, I think that's not the case. In fact, the story was that they offered it to Verizon first, and Verizon said no.
Yeah.
Because Apple was insisting on huge concessions. No phone company had ever given a handset manufacturer before. Yeah. And Verizon said, what are you nuts? Get out of here.
So the question is if Verizon had said yes, would they have stuck with CDMA and then not been released on AT&T? Till much longer, would they have kept the exclusivity with Verizon? I don't think they could have necessarily done that.
It wasn't until recently that you could, in a small form factor, have both radios.
Yeah.
So, I mean, what's happened is Qualcomm's made joint chips, GSM CDMA chips. I mean, the world has changed. In 2007, none of that was really doable. Now, but having said that, there are these chips now, and there's no reason Nokia couldn't make a Lumia 920. Just as, you know, I got the Verizon iPhone 5. This is a miracle because it has CDMA on Verizon and has an unlocked GSM slot. So it's like I can do anything with it. And there's no reason that Nokia could not have done that. I mean, it's not like this is ginormous or something, you know?
Yeah. Well, they are trying to re-enter the North American market, right? So maybe there's some of that going on.
Historically, they've not done, this is where Nokia dropped the ball. They had no carrier deals.
Yeah.
So I'm not going to blame Microsoft. I may not blame Verizon. It might really be Nokia.
Yeah.
Which would be kind of
sick. I'm trying to look up a spec chart while we're talking. But yeah, it could be. And you know, the other thing though is when Nokia did come to the US, their premier launch partner was AT&T. Like they were all tied up with AT&T.
Right.
They had exclusives, right? And AT&T ponied up money, you know, not enough, obviously, because we're still only 3% market share, but they ponied up money to launch these phones and promote them in their stores. You know, I'm sure that plays into why did they do the deal just with AT&T? But yeah, that's a problem because Verizon's the biggest U.S. carrier. And it's not just me who wants this. Mm-hmm. I'm positive.
Well, now, the bottom line is we can't expect this platform to succeed if we're not on all the major carriers. I mean, that's the bottom line. So if AT&T is going to have exclusivity and really promote the 920, that's great and all. But, you know, it comes at a loss over the long term. So I think Microsoft knows that. Certainly, we haven't heard what the plans are for the HTC or the ATIV, the Samsung ATIV device. So there's some other devices that we'll probably hear about.
Bad news. AT&T released, I don't know when they did it, a couple of days ago, I think, a press release. Maybe it was today, that they're going to have, AT&T's going to have the HTC 8X as well.
Oh, no kidding.
No word from Verizon.
Then all hope is lost, Leo.
All hope is lost. No. You have to go. What's wrong with AT&T?
I'm on AT&T. It's great. I feel for my brethren who want to stay on Verizon and they want a great Windows phone experience. I mean, it just has to be there. So
AT&T announced today it is growing its 4G LTE smartphone portfolio. We'll soon welcome three new devices from HTC, the One X, the One VX, and the Windows Phone 8X. And I see the word exclusive in here.
Ooh, good.
HTC, the exclusive provider of the One X, will add two more exclusive devices. Nope, that's for the Android. Let's see. Let's scroll down. Launching next month, the Windows Phone 8X by HTC will be the first ever Windows 8 smartphone with Beats. Long tradition of the best of world-class products, quad core. I don't see exclusive when it comes to the Windows phone. So that's good news because the fact that they used exclusive for the others and didn't use it for the 8X might indicate that there will be another carrier.
I'm looking now at WP Central as a good spec comparison chart. And they say for the Lumia 920, here are all the things that it supports. GSM, obviously. WCDMA.
Oh.
LTE.
Oh.
The various flavors of that. So, no, it's not because of that. It's because of something else.
Okay, good. Well done.
Yeah.
So it isn't that.
It's a good thing we had a reporter here.
Thank God we got somebody who actually does some work.
I should have known that, but I
prefer just to speculate wildly, Mary.
Absolutely. Why not?
This is not reportage.
I'm hoping that there's going to be some mystery device, Lumia 922, something like that, on Verizon. And you know why? Because I want to have a choice. I want to be able to choose among multiple awesome phones. Because, you know, I really like the HTC 8X for the brief moment I got to hold it. And it would be really great to have a choice. That's what I want, a choice.
I saw that Lumia, the red Lumia, and I thought for sure that was going to land on Verizon. I thought AT&T was going to get the blue one and yellow one and Verizon was going to get the... I would have loved to have seen an announcement today just saying that it was going to be on both carriers. End of story. Let's keep going. You know, that would have been great. But that's not how the carriers work.
I'm looking back and it does look like when HTC announced the 8X, they said it would be on Verizon, T-Mobile, and AT&T.
Really?
Yeah. So that's from September 18th. That's from...
But the bigger news is, like you said, the fact that it's coming in cyan. That's huge for me because I have the cyan. I have the headphones. I have all the accessories. And I saw this yellow device and I was going, you got to be kidding me. Now I got to go out and buy all new headphones and everything
else.
You
really go for matching headphones. Isn't that sweet?
I know.
Isn't that cute?
Well, you know, it matches my shirt. And
I kinda... Actually, no, Mary Jo and I both have are on record as saying we like cyan.
Yes. It's great, right? I love that color.
Yeah. I'm liking the yellow, too. I like the yellow headphones.
You're wearing the yellow headphones. Look at that. Damn. Very styling. That's kind of bright. Just a little bright.
Can't miss
kind
it.
Of an announcement. I am using an emergency phone. Do not get in my way.
Well, it's funny because at the launch event, all the employees were wearing red and yellow and everything else, and it looked like a McDonald's commercial. It was kind of all these bright colors.
Just in case you're curious, it's not just you, Ryan. I mean, Travis, the fashion plate. Jessica Alba also sports the cyan.
I saw that.
Lumia 920. She probably got in a gift bag from the Oscars or some such crap.
How dare you, Leo? She bought that. She was first in line.
She bought that. She looks happy.
Yeah.
She looks very happy sporting her
Fendi bag. She's Jessica Alba.
Bag.
How could she be unhappy?
Yeah, that's right. Sure.
Didn't Steve Wozniak have a cyan Lumia too?
Did he really? Yeah. I know he has one of everything.
He has a Lumia, I believe.
Yeah.
Interesting. Well, I've been, you know, I was going to get the 920 until you told me no to get the 8X. So,
wait and see. Wait and see.
You said wait and see?
Yeah.
What am I waiting to see?
You're waiting to actually get to try these things since none of us have gotten to try them.
Try it. Yeah. Then you can't
be the first. Try scrolling on it and launching an app, perhaps.
That's one thing. And I have to say, in Windows Phone favor, because Microsoft's been so tight with the specs. That you pretty much know that they're all going to be about the same, right?
Yeah.
Certainly, Windows Phone 7 was that way, but specs a little less tight this time around. But you knew if you got any Windows Phone 7, they'd all be, you know, roughly the same performance.
Yeah, I think perception, though, is key here. In fact, on our show, we do a weigh-in Wednesday where we ask our listeners, you know, various questions. And this week happened to be, what is the best Windows Phone 8 device? Now, clearly, none of them are available.
Right.
But our listeners said 78% said the Lumia 920 they perceived as being the best device. And I think, obviously, that's because... You know, Nokia is all in with Windows Phone, and you know some of the enthusiasts really like the Nokia story and all that. And frankly, the apps are fantastic. Like Nokia Drive is an absolutely fantastic app for offline maps and you know directions, turn by turn directions, and everything else. In fact, it's probably one of my most important apps on my phone, and so it keeps me in the on the Lumia line. So. So it is kind of interesting that the perception here is that, you know, Nokia makes the Windows Phone, you know, that they're the flagship provider.
I didn't think about apps. Good point.
Yeah. You know, it's funny because when they first started talking about these exclusive apps from the manufacturers, I was really concerned about that. You know, being a developer, I thought, you know, this is kind of not fair because these devices are going to get shipped. And obviously, if I make a mapping app, let's say, although I wouldn't, what's to stop Nokia from making sure their Drive app is really heavily promoted and mine gets, you know, lost in obscurity? And I've actually changed my opinion on that. I think overall it's better for consumers. And if it means that we get those hard, you know, core apps that people need and they work very, very well, then that just frankly means more devices in people's hands. And that's what we want. So as we were seeing with iOS 6 maps and all the hubbub over that, that's one area Nokia can say, hey, we've got some really good maps on our phone. And if that's a big issue for somebody, you know, maybe they travel a lot and they need good, reliable maps, both offline and online, you know, Lumia might seem appealing or appealing alternative.
Right. Bing Maps are everywhere.
Chat room.
I mean, Nokia Maps are in Bing Maps and Bing Maps are in all of Windows Phone 8. So you get the Nokia Maps.
Yeah, they will be. They're currently not, right? Oh. So for Windows Phone 7, but...
But they will be in 8. We don't know.
We haven't really seen how that's going to look. We've been told that they're going to be using some Nokia Maps, right, Mary Jo?
Yeah, I thought that an announcement had gone out at that Nokia event here in New York that it would be using Nokia Maps, like all Windows Phone 8 devices. I thought so.
Yeah, but I'd be curious what the turn-by-turn, you know, specific features would look like. I know that, you know, right. The phone has being turn-by-turn, but it's it's largely inadequate when it comes to, I mean, Drive is like a fully fledged, I mean, they've worked on that for some time now. It's very mature, a turn-by-turn application. So, I mean, that would be great. I mean, if they could somehow get that from Nokia and allow all the manufacturers to be able to provide that on their phones. If I were Nokia, though, I'd be saying, no, you can maybe have our maps, but, you know, we're going to keep Drive and all the turn-by-turn stuff ours.
Yep. I have a question for the chat room because somebody on Twitter, Ran BLV, is saying he does not think WCDMA has anything to do with CDMA being on Verizon.
Oh, really?
So I don't know if anybody out there knows.
Let me look up I wonder what WCDMA is.
I just looked it up and it looks like it may be something related to Docomo in Japan. But
it's wideband CDMA. It's not what Verizon does.
Right, right.
Okay. So it's
we're back to maybe that's the reason.
Yeah. So it doesn't have
CDMA. They do
CDMA
have LTE.
Wait a minute. WCDMA is a 3G technology. It's a 3G technology used by AT&T and T-Mobile. So wideband. They're much. So HSDPA and HSPA replaced.
I need to know who to blame, Leo. Please tell me who I'm supposed to blame.
I think you blame Nokia. Okay. Because WCDMA is a data technology. It is not a voice technology.
Okay.
So it does not have CDMA, the voice CDMA.
All right, I'm going to place my blame with Nokia then. Thank you.
Google says, according to the Google and RitDog in our chat room, Nokia launched a special CDMA Lumia 800C in China. But it's the C, right? And it's an 800. That's interesting. It sounds like that it's just a hardware issue, but who knows?
Maybe.
Who knows?
Could be. If it's that, then I'm not as mad as I was this morning.
and this is frankly why I'm nervous about Microsoft entering this space with their hardware, right? It gets very convoluted, complicated, and I'm thinking, you know what? Let's focus on making a really cool Xbox. How about that?
Yeah. All right. Let's see here. What else do we have to talk about? I think we could take a break and come back. Talk more about October 26th. There's other stuff going on that day. It's going to be a magical day for Microsoft, for everybody. And I have to check because I may be wrong. I may have misremembered the pop-up store date. Somebody sent me an email, and it sounds like they're all going to launch on the same day. But I will check. Meanwhile, while I'm doing that, Leo is going to talk about Squarespace. Travis, you use Squarespace?
I do.
We don't use it on our
site. So if the Twitter horde is headed over to our site now, it's probably crashed. But we should
do that. Let's do that. Let's just crash.
WindowsDeveloperShow.com.
Yeah, everybody go to WindowsDeveloperShow.com. And then
I will wear it like a badge of honor.
It crashed Windows Developer Show. But then after that, go to inside.twit.tv, which is a Squarespace site. And you cannot crash it. Ha ha!
Yeah.
Ooh, the new limited edition.
But I'll tell you where Squarespace comes in handy is I get, you know, being a developer, I get asked a bazillion times if I can help people build their websites. And Squarespace is where I just say, listen,
you say no.
I love you. Yeah, I'm sure you got a great thing going on. I'd love to support you, but here's Squarespace and you'll be fine. You'll be taken care of.
You know, I think that actually that may be the secret most common reason why geeks like Squarespace. They can foist their relatives and friends and say, look, you got a wedding, you got a baby, you got a new business. Go to Squarespace.com. You can do this yourself. Squarespace is hosting plus software that's very easy to use, very powerful. And if you are a developer, you can use CSS and JavaScript and HTML5 and all those technologies. In fact, they have a code editor that's great with colored syntax coloring and all sorts of stuff. But you don't need to. You could start with their gorgeous templates, just gorgeous. And then these are, by the way, adaptive design, responsive design templates. So when you put a picture in, for instance, it automatically makes thumbnails in 7 different sizes so that it looks great on anything from a Windows phone to a 27-inch Dell XPS 1. I mean, this really is beautiful, responsive design. And here's how easy it is to customize. When you're on the template, you could just literally drag and drop to rearrange, to change the width of columns, to put different plugins in there. They've got great little plugins for Twitter and Facebook and Flickr and LinkedIn and all the social networks. You can import your data from your existing blog, Tumblr, WordPress, Blogger, and export it too. You're never trapped in Squarespace. The new Squarespace 6 is the most powerful, slick version of Squarespace ever. Designed for all the convenience, all the power, make a great-looking website. And the thing that blows me away is the pricing on Squarespace. After, you know, when you hear all the features you're going to get, that's going to cost a mint. No. The basic site, $8 a month when you buy an annual plan. I would recommend the unlimited plan because it's only $16 a month, and you get unlimited pages, galleries, blogs, unlimited bandwidth, unlimited storage, unlimited contributors. They will, when you buy an annual plan, automatically register any custom domain you want and tie it into the Squarespace site, so it's automatic. Squarespace is great for people who want to, artists and photographers who want to do portfolios. Really exceptional for that. If you go in the portfolio templates, you can see the great designs for people who are in the arts. I'm a big fan of Squarespace for photographers. There, you can use much more expensive commercial photography site designers, and you won't get anything nearly as slick as modern as this. You know, keep up. Squarespace 6 available right now. If you want to try it for free, you can. You just click that button, and you got 2 weeks free, no credit card needed. If you decide it's time for you to buy, take a look at the pricing and do the annual package. That's all I can say. You'll save a lot of money when you use our offer code Windows 10, because you get 10% off your first purchase. So get 10% for the next 12 months by buying the annual plan, and you get the custom domain and the automatic hookup. The unlimited plan is great if you're going to really do a big website. I can't believe unlimited bandwidth and storage. I don't know how they do that. Squarespace.com. Our offer code, if you decide to buy, save 10% when you use Windows 10 as the offer code. If you're a geek and your family and friends keep saying, hey, you could do a website, right? Wouldn't take you very long, would it? No, come on. You could do a website. Just say, you know, I could, but why don't you try Squarespace? You'll love it.
You have no idea how many times I've been saved.
It's really true. Oh. It's really true.
Now all the family that's listening, they're like, oh, so that's why he's in the Squarespace.
Oh, he probably makes money on it. Oh, it's a profit thing.
No, it is not a profit thing. It's a sanity thing. It's maintaining my sanity.
Yeah. It's really true. Great for online portfolios, too. All right, let's move on. October 26th, the big day, not just for the Windows 8 launch, the Surface launch, the pop-up stores. How many of them? 30?
32. Holiday pop-up stores, yep.
All across the U.S. and Canada. Not in Visalia. Sorry, Travis. But as you said, the nearest one would be Pasadena?
Glendale and San Francisco. And I think someone said Santa Clara, I was seeing in the chat room. So I got a few options.
All right. I like it. And when you go in that pop-up store, what are they going to have in there?
Everything? Well, we haven't seen everything. Yeah, I don't know. They're going to definitely have Windows 8 PCs and Windows RT PCs, I would think, and tablets. Probably also the Surface RT. No, actually, definitely the Surface
RT. They'll have to have that. Yeah.
They'll have to. I would bet Xbox. I would bet Kinect. I would bet some games.
I just want a one place, and I'm sure this is why Microsoft's doing it, that I can see all the Windows 8 PCs. Because some have touch, some have all-in-one. I mean, there's different. Yeah. The designs are more varied than we've seen on PCs in years. So I want to see them side by side so I can decide which one.
Yes.
That's the best.
I'll tell you what they won't have. I'm going to almost say with certainty is they're not going to have Machine Gun Kelly, the artist rapper. They will definitely not have
Why
him.
Not? Why no Machine Gun Kelly? I was counting on that.
Well, apparently he at an Atlanta store at the opening completely thrashed it and was jumping on tables, and they had to call the police and everything else. It was quite the
Was that recently?
Yeah, I think that happened. I don't know. The chat room can help us out with that.
He's denying that.
He's denying it, but
he says it didn't happen.
Well, there's video. There's video. And yeah. Leo, if you don't pull
I don't
video,
care
be
if
careful.
There's video. I don't care if there's video. I deny it. He says, yeah. I didn't destroy computers or other property. I was performing. I was performing. My only goal was to give a great performance. I did not stomp on any computers, nor were the police called. There was some confusion, he says, as to where I should perform. Apparently, he decided that on a table would be the best place to do it. We won't play the audio because I think the audio is
dangerous. Yeah, be careful with that. It's not safe for work, yeah. Thing.
But apparently, he decided at some point to get up on a table and stand on some computers. But he did not emphatically at any point ruin any. So somebody paid him to do this. This was not, he was not a spontaneous performance.
Unfortunately, yes. Somebody actually paid this man to do this.
Wow. Somebody at a Microsoft store.
Yes. Yeah, I would assume so. It's a PR.
It wasn't the mall.
Or somebody that used to work at a Microsoft store. I don't know. Good.
This is going downhill. He's already now throwing promotional. Excuse me, Mr. Kelly. Mr. Yeah. Machine Gun Kelly, you can't throw that around. I'm sorry. That's promotional material. Oh, no. Please don't step on the Surface tablet there. That's not for you.
So they had to turn a sound off, and then folks were kind of booing.
Wait
and
a minute.
That turned into quite a thing.
Oh, this is not good.
Yeah. I don't know who, you know, they've actually had some really great artists. They had Dave Matthews at one point opening one of their stores.
Can I give you a hand? It's always worked for Apple. John Meyer. He's a nice boy. He never destroys anything. it's very calming and soothing. Oh, dear. Oh, no. Oh,
yeah, it just gets pretty wild.
He's jumping all over the tables. You know, so he's got a big crowd, though. I don't know. Oh,
what, I think that's more Machine Gun Kelly, the reason why there's not a big crowd.
Mr. Kelly, please don't step on the machines there. Huh, interesting. But, you know, you hire a rapper.
Yeah.
So he says, basically said, you know, the problem was there was some confusion over where I should perform.
On a table or not on a table?
Yeah, how about in the store or not in the store? I think that's where the confusion was.
Yeah. Okay. Oh, I feel bad for him, actually.
Really?
Oh, well, look at it. They shut him down.
Oh, I guess this is where I...
He had to leave. Oh, no, he's a little hurt. He's a little hurt. They're saying, please, Mr. Kelly, would you please leave, Mr. Kelly. I'm sorry. I apologize. We're going to just... Could you go next door to the Apple store, please, sir? Come on.
I guarantee you Apple would have been smart enough to not have him in their store.
I'm telling you, John Mayer.
Yeah, you might be right.
Musical stylings of Mr. Michael Bublé. That's safe.
I think the PR, you know, must have thought, you know, we'll do something really edgy. And, you know, Machine Gun Kelly's kind of an up-and-comer, and it backfired. Apparently, in his shows and stuff, he climbs up on the stage and does, and he's quite known for this. So somebody didn't do their homework. But anyhow.
I like him. I think he's a talented kid, talented performer. He brought some life to that store.
He brought something.
Yes.
I like him. We're going to get a new Zoom Pass, perhaps. Zoom Pass 2.0, October 26th.
Yeah.
Too bad Paul's not here. He'd be all excited.
He did report some of this already, too. But The Verge had a story this week saying it's going to happen on October 26th, and that there'll be somehow some free streaming that's ad-supported alongside of the subscription capabilities that you get today in Zoom Pass. And so, you know, this is going to be rebranded as Xbox Music. It's going to be a subscription service. We already knew that. But supposedly it all gets turned on October 26th, which makes a lot of sense since that's the day you can buy Windows 8 PCs and tablets and Surfaces. So, yeah.
We talked on This Week in Google about the fact that Microsoft was relaunching a news operation. You know, they used to have MSNBC. They sold it back to NBC. But on Windows 8, they've got that great news tile. And it actually looks beautiful when you open it. It's full screen pictures and images. So apparently they're hiring editorial. They're going to rebuild a news division.
Yeah, I talked to them about this this past week. And what they're doing is they had about, I think, 50 to 100 people who worked for MSNBC in the newsroom. And so now that they're not part of the NBC part of the news operation anymore, they're going to staff back up. And so these people are going to be basically reporters like we are, but they're going to do general news, and they're still going to take feeds from the AP and Reuters and run all of these together in the MSM portal. So all of these different sources will be what is the news tab on the MSM portal.
Cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So journalists who are out of work, if you are looking for a gig, I think they're hiring actually over on MSM.
Here's your chance.
Yep.
The MSM portal will be more than news, though, I presume.
It will. They're going to do a special version of the MSM portal that's optimized for Windows 8 and IE 10. So if you use it today on Windows 7, you're not going to see the same version that people will see on Windows 8. And it's all touch optimized. It looks really nice. I got to see a preview of it. It launches on October 26th, so you'll get to see it then. It has support for gestures like Snap. All the flip ahead kinds of things that you can do with Windows 8 inside Pages. So, yeah, all of these things are going to be there. There's going to be sports and news and entertainment, all the things that you get on MSN today, but all, can I say it, reimagined?
Oh, don't. No.
No. No.
No. Not that word.
Sorry.
No.
Reimagined.
You can use fast
Windows
and fluid. Use fast and fluid.
Fast, it's fluid and it's reimagined.
Oh, gosh. No. I just had an aneurysm.
No, but it's not Metro.
No.
No.
But it is a Windows Store style. So Metro style, whatever you want to call it. Yes.
And yeah, perhaps IE 10. Now, we know IE 10 will come out for Windows 8. I guess the rumor is that maybe they'll do a Windows 7 version as well.
Right. So we know there is a Windows 7 version of IE 10. They tested it last year. Then they abruptly stopped testing it. And a lot of people were saying, oh, maybe they killed it. Maybe they're not doing it. But they are going to do it. The thing is, we just don't know when. We keep asking. So when are you going to bring out IE 10 for Windows 7, Microsoft? And we get no comment today. Maybe
when,
another
Microsoft,
day.
When?
So it would make a lot of sense on October 26th, right? Since you're launching IE 10 and Windows 8, would make a lot of sense if you could throw Windows 7 users a bone. Hey, here's IE 10.
Throw me a frickin' bone.
Exactly.
Yeah. All right. And finally, wait a minute. Windows 8 preview just out as of today. I don't understand.
The Firefox preview.
Oh, I missed the word Firefox. Okay. So there's a Firefox version. This is not a Metro version. This is a desktop version.
It's both.
Really?
This version of Firefox runs in both the Windows 8 Classic desktop environment and the new Metro environment, says Mozilla.
Huh.
So that's good.
Weren't they complaining about that? That said,
yeah.
That,
yeah, they were. They were.
But now they are they saying, well, we were wrong?
I'm not exactly sure what they're saying. They were complaining that they weren't going to. Well, actually, what they were complaining about was if you decide to make Firefox your default browser, that it basically lessens some of the capabilities that you're going to have on Windows 8.
So don't
Same
make
thing
it
with,
your default?
Right. Don't make it your default, but you can use it if you want to use it sometimes, I guess.
Well, that's the same with Chrome, right? If you make Chrome your default browser on Windows 8, it'll remove the Internet Explorer metrified version of,
really?
Of Internet Explorer.
Is
yeah,
that,
it actually just removes it from
the EU? Is that like some sort of obscure concession to lawsuits or is it something? I mean, why?
Because the world is broken, Leo.
We don't want that tile to confuse you. But it's just a tile gone, right? You could still run the Metro IE 10.
No, I don't think so. Oh. Can you? I think it's they kind of discourage the Metrified version of IE when you make another browser.
I think if that's not an actual inspired by the European Union move, it's a way of saying neener, neener, neener to the European Union, right? Okay, you didn't want it. Well, there. And actually, it has the reverse effect. It disincentivizes you to make Firefox or Chrome your default browser.
Yeah, it kind of does.
Because you lose and capabilities. Now, it doesn't add capabilities. You lose them.
And now I'm thinking about it. When you're in like a Twitter client, for instance, and you click a link or, excuse me, press a link, it usually opens up the default IE. So if that is the case and you've made Chrome your default browser, I wonder what it actually does.
Is it the case that somebody said in the chat room, a Rev said in the chat room, no, because you can only have one Metro browser at a time.
Yeah.
I don't see that as being.
If you make IE10 the browser, the default browser, will it put the tile back? Must.
It does.
Okay.
Yeah. I did, because I did that on my loaner tablet. I installed Chrome, made it my default browser, then I took it off as a default browser, and it went back to what it was.
Okay. So,
yeah, it does.
Whether that's a technical requirement or just
some
other reason.
Yeah, so, but you're right. You're totally right, Leo. If it's not already a problem with the EU regulators, it will be for sure.
Well, what have you done now, Microsoft? We will check this and we'll get back to you.
And Steve Guggenheimer is just a name we like to say, so I'm going to say it. He is now head of DPE, Department of Public Acronyms. What?
Yeah, no. Department. Developer and Platform Evangelist. The good old DPE. Yeah, so this is kind of a weird move right before the launch of Windows 8, but maybe it's a good move. I don't know. The long-standing head of DPE is stepping aside, and Steve Guggenheimer, who's worked at Microsoft forever, I mean, before Windows 95, like, he's older than me.
You know, that name does sound familiar.
He's been at Microsoft forever, and he used to run the OEM division. That was his last gig right before this, but now he's going to head up DPE, which is the part of Microsoft, I think, where Ryan Lowdermilk works, perhaps.
Yeah, this is his new boss, so I have nothing but kind words to say to Steve. He is a great, great man.
Wonderful fellow. We just adore him. Yes.
You know, it's interesting because Charlie Kindle actually wrote a blog post, and he some of you might know Charlie from old Windows Phone fame, and he left, I think, last September, actually. Mary Jo would know better than I would. But, you know, he claims that, you know, there really isn't any better month to move on if you're ready to move than September, because that's when you get all your bonuses. Oh. So I wonder if... you know, this is sometimes it kind of gets positioned as, oh, you know, Windows 8 is in trouble and people are, you know, leaving a sinking ship. And it quite possibly could be something as simple as he was already planning on leaving and he was just waiting for his bonus.
He was waiting for his free Surface tablet, his Surface PC, his Windows 8 phone, and now he can go.
Yeah.
I got
it. It might just be something as simple as that.
He was waiting for the Microsoft swag bag.
But, you know, it's a good time to have... some things going on with developer and platform evangelism. Since we've got 3,600 apps in the store, good time to get more people interested in writing apps for Windows 8. So hopefully Steve Guggenheimer is going to really rev up the developing community and get them.
You know, wouldn't you want to bring in a young, hip guy instead of some, well, maybe he's like revered by the developer community. Maybe that's it.
I've obviously interacted with a lot of the developer evangelists just doing the show and certainly through my brother and stuff. And these guys, I mean, they are a motivated bunch and they are super enthused about Windows. And
that's
one thing, you know. Yeah, I mean, and it's one thing that I think Microsoft, frankly, doesn't get too much credit for in the sense that they really make all these code camps. And there's so many opportunities, especially for student developers through their DreamSpark initiatives. You know, they do put a lot of effort and they know that developers matter. And of course we hear developers and all that, but, the developer evangelists are the key kind of component to all of that. So it's a big group, man. There's a ton of people and they're all running around the country trying to get people excited. And it's kind of a interesting world he's stepping into.
Speaking of that, I saw this, and I'm really glad you're on actually today, Travis, because I saw this this story that this new JavaScript is it a framework? TypeScript.
TypeScript is something that's new, and here's the thing. So you know,
it
as
comes
a developer,
from the guy who created C Sharp.
Exactly. And as developers, you know when you go to a family picnic and they say, don't talk about religion and politics, you know, developers aren't supposed to talk about programming languages because people get very upset.
Oh, yeah. Well, I'm a Python guy, and I know you happen to be a Rubyist, so the hell with you.
Exactly. You're just expect email from folks saying that never have me on the show again. I'm not a JavaScript developer. I'm a C# developer. But I will say this: the intent with TypeScript is essentially to make JavaScript more manageable.
Is it now, a generator? Is it a code generator?
Yeah. So you basically type in JavaScript, it'll compile out to JavaScript. So,
but you write it in what? C#? You write
it's a bit.
You'd write JavaScript and it gives you JavaScript? It seems like not much of an improvement.
Well, it's a variant, right? So it's like I would say it's kind of a melding of C sharp and JavaScript to a certain extent. I know you can copy JavaScript in there if you want, but you don't have to. The key is that you're going to be able to take advantage of the things that other languages like C sharp provide, like the module systems, these strongly typed.
Oh, it adds typing. Oh,
yeah. And that's a huge complaint for JavaScript. Oh,
okay. So some people will hate this. They'll say, no, because I want the exactly. freedom of JavaScript. Exactly. Others will say, no, because you can't really write real applications in this because it doesn't do typing. You don't have classes. You don't have modules. Okay. I get it.
Yeah.
And it is very controversial. It's controversial inside Microsoft and outside. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah.
There are people inside Microsoft who hate this and are tweeting very vocally against it. There are other people at Microsoft saying, thank goodness, you know, before it was like impossible to do any really large scale application with JavaScript. Like, thank God they're doing this because we need the things like typing and classes and modules, right? And get over it that it's Microsoft. It's open source. It's under an Apache license.
Right.
Yeah.
Believe it or not.
And I think that's probably the more important point for your listeners and, you know, kind of getting it out of the developer sphere is that Microsoft's making a very concerted effort to woo these web developers, right? Obviously, with the emergence of HTML5, JavaScript, and these kinds of languages, you know, you could be a very successful developer and not technically build Windows applications, right? So this is, I think, a really great pivot in the right direction.
Use this for web applications, though, for client side, or would you? Is it like Node.js that you might use it server side, or does it not that specific?
You would use it server side, I believe.
It's server side. Okay.
So yeah.
Is it a competitor to Node.js?
No. And some people also are using it to build Windows Store apps, or they're encouraging people
exactly.
to. So it can be used for the client and the server. You know, Microsoft, when they were talking to me about TypeScript, they said, you know, we really saw the problem that this is meant to address when we've been trying to do JavaScript programming around things like Bing Maps and Office 365. So these are gigantic projects.
Of course, they would hate JavaScript.
They're using it. And in fact, on Windows 8, they're backing that people write apps in JavaScript. So this is a really different Microsoft than you used to see.
This makes sense. They need something like this to give you strong typing, to give you classes and modules, so that, you know, I mean, it's now a kind of a full-fledged programming language.
Yeah. And there's also an element that supposedly allows you to write less code. Actually, I was talking to Ryan this morning, and he was saying that there's a picture out there on the interwebs of Anders at a conference, and he's got this screenshot of where he's writing in TypeScript, and then on the right hand side you can see the converted JavaScript, and he's got, like, you know, only a few lines of code, and it's producing, you know, a very long, you know, subset of JavaScript. So I think that kind of is indicative of what they're trying to go for, very kind of tight, organized code, especially for, like Mary Jo said, for those large scale projects. But ultimately at the end of the day, you end up with JavaScript when it's all said and done.
So this is both simultaneously going to inflame some and reassure others.
Exactly.
It's a free Visual Studio add-on that enables more learned professional developers to adopt more formal approaches in producing code for the web. You know, I don't think there's anything wrong with that. You don't have to use it.
Exactly. And as a C# developer, I'm not going to run out and go, you know, master JavaScript, you know, to do this. I think this is far more, you know, like Mary Jo was saying, you know, if I'm a web developer and I'm kind of interested in this new Windows platform, you know, this new Metro UI, whatever you want to call it, you know, then building an app is going to be far easier. I mean, we have folks out in the field right now copying and pasting their code, HTML code, their JavaScript code, and making Windows apps. So it is very, very possible.
It just enforces the rules of a strongly typed language and gives you some capabilities you might expect as a professional.
You said that.
That might ruffle a couple feathers. Yeah.
Well, but you don't have to use it. Go ahead. You use JavaScript the way you like it. If you don't, you know, you don't like typing, you don't have to use type.
But one thing we should bring up, because I've had a ton of people ask me this, is does this mean, because Anders Heilsberg, the father of C#, is backing this, that C# is done? No, this does not mean that. No. They're still going to keep going with C#. Yeah. There's more versions of C# coming, and he's still working on that too. So don't worry if you are someone who likes C#. This does not mean he's jumping ship.
And Google's
if C#
doing
is done, I'm going to walk into incoming traffic. Yeah, okay,
no,
so let's
no,
just.
You already learned that piece of crap, that language, and now, now you've got to live with
exactly.
it.
Yeah. Exactly.
Google's doing the same kind of stuff. I mean, anybody, you know, this is something. And Apple, there's Apple stuff like this too, not done by Apple, but there's some really interesting JavaScript generators and so forth. I think this
well,
is.
Well, CoffeeScript is.
That's what I was thinking of, CoffeeScript, yeah.
Yeah.
There's ScriptSharp, which also is another one. And, you know, there's a lot of people were asking, too, why didn't Microsoft just back Dart, which is what Google's doing in this space? Well, for one, it's Google. That's probably the biggest one. But that's why.
Right. And, you know, having Anders do it gives it a certain amount of credibility.
Does.
And
there's
it comes
actually
from Microsoft.
A team
it's
like,
your Visual Studio. I mean, there's a certain lot, that's, lot to be said for this.
There's like 50 people behind this. There's a team of 50 people I heard on TypeScript. And it's, you know, they've got the heavy hitters on there. There's a few other Microsoft distinguished engineers and stuff. It's not some little toy project they're going to do and then toss out. This is here for
And what it
for
really staying. Is that I think is interesting is an acknowledgement that, that JavaScript's here to stay and that much of the, especially UI stuff and web stuff will be done in JavaScript. So even apps will be done in JavaScript. So you need to have a maybe a more professional way to do
it. And frankly, Microsoft needs those developers, right?
Right.
And we talked about this a little bit last week, is that we need great designers and great developers that are kind of doing these things already on the web. So any way we can make that path a little easier, I'm all for it.
And it's open source.
Yeah.
Which I really like.
And it works with all the, your other JavaScript libraries. So you can use jQuery. You can use all the ones that you're, you know, you don't have to give up any of those.
Oh, that's interesting. So you could still, okay, so you can still use all of that.
Yeah.
Okay. That's interesting. And I presume, was it designed, Leon Zandman says in our chat room, and I think he's probably right, probably designed internal as an internal tool initially.
I would bet so.
I would think so, yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, there's got to be a lot of pressure at Microsoft to write reliable code at this point.
Yes.
Trying to put this in a delicate way. But that's one of the things you get from strong typing and classes and modules is you can have more reliable, robust code.
Well, I mean, one could argue that TypeScript will help you write good JavaScript, right?
Strong typing is a huge thing for developers to enforce. You know, avoiding some major blunders that you can make that it can cause security holes.
Sure.
I would think that that's part of it. Hey, we're going to take a break. Yep. We've got picks, tips, and code names coming up. Our code name today sounds like it comes from a Fellini film. but first, let's talk about audible.com. I love audiobooks. You love audiobooks. Who doesn't love audiobooks? And I've got a way you can get... Let me introduce you to audible.com. I shouldn't assume everybody's an Audible listener. In fact, we've been talking about Audible for so long now, I just figured you've all kind of become subscribers. But if you haven't, you're missing out. It's a great audio bookstore, 100,000 books. Pretty much now Audible, and I give them a lot of credit for this. They have made it so that when a new book comes out, it almost always has an Audible version. It's just the done thing because a lot of people listen to books now. J.K. Rowling's newest, The Casual Vacancy, her first adult novel, out in hardcover and on Audible at the same time. And I could over and over again, a lot of great fiction and nonfiction, history, science fiction. Kenny Rogers' new memoir is out. Now that I got to listen to. You got to know when to hold him. He doesn't narrate it. Oh, man, I'd like to hear him narrate. Oh, man.
Does he explain the line of Roasters Restaurants? That we really got to dig into that.
Kenny Rogers Roasters Restaurants. Mm-mm-mm. I'm sure it's in there somewhere. You picked a fine time to bankrupt Lucille. there's so many good books in here. If you like sleazy Hollywood memoirs, it's a great place. If you like, classic history books. This is a great book. History is one of those things that I stopped reading because I just didn't have time, you know. And now I'm back listening to great history books. Just finished a history of World War II that Paul Thurrott recommended. I just adored. And I felt like, it's so great. And yesterday, John Hodgman, who, by the way, you guys ought to like because he played the PC on the Mac versus PC ads. He was in our studio doing Triangulation, our interview show. Great guy. A little weird. Took off his shoes, but that's okay. Took off his socks. Okay, that was going a little far. But anyway, maybe it was, I blame the alcoholic whipped cream I plied him with. But anyway, he was here to talk about his new book, That Is All, which is now out on Audible. Took him a year because, listen, who's on this book? John Hamm from Mad Men. Dick Cavett. The great Jonathan Coulton. Paul Rudd. Brooke Shields performs on this book. There's a cast of thousands. Rachel Maddow, Stephen Fry. In all of this, it's the funniest book you've ever heard. I don't know what part. I think it's, I'll listen to a little bit of this.
Specifically, they now live in a secret village hidden in the woods of the American Northeast.
This is his
third.
Where
they do not acknowledge the time has moved beyond May 21st, 1980.
This is third in a trilogy of books that basically comprise all known knowledge. And actually what it is just completely fake trivia.
Which you will certainly recognize as the original release date of The Empire Strikes Back. There, they are being trained in a simple, even crude way of life. But I might even say a richer one.
If you listen to this book and you do not laugh out loud every single page, you're just not paying attention. So how would you like to get this for free? Or any one of almost all of their 100,000 books. Some of the longer books are multiple credits, but most of them are single credit. Here's the deal. Go to audible.com/windows and sign up for the gold plan today. Your first month's free. That means your first book is free. Cancel at any time. Pay nothing. And, look at this. Here we go. Baratunde's book is here. How to Be Black. Baratunde narrates it. Wonderful. Tell you, there's so many great books. I'm sorry, now I'm making it hard for you. Because now I've given you two books you might want to listen to.
American opportunity could be satisfied either through a comprehensive program of economic and political empowerment.
And but Jeff Jarvis's book is there too. Public Parts, How Sharing in the Digital Age Improves the Way We Work and Live, narrated by Jeff.
But also easier. As I always have researchers and editors at the ready.
Audible. See, now I just made it hard, didn't I? Audible.com/windows. The Audible app on your Windows phone or on your Android or iPhone, it just really makes it great. I have all of the books I've ever purchased over the 12 years I've been a member of Audible are available to me. I have over 500 books that I've listened to on Audible.com, and they're all there, and I love it. I'm a fan. Give it a try. Audible.com/windows. Your first book is free when you sign up today. Audible.com/windows. What have you? You listen to audio? You said you listen to audio books, right, Ryan? Travis?
Yes, absolutely. Yes. I'm a big Audible fan.
Do you have one you want to recommend? Since we've already.
The thing is I listen to all the ones you guys recommend. So, I don't have anything new, but
Andy Anatko listens to.
I'm doing Salem's Lot.
Oh,
I'm a big Stephen King fan,
that one's been great. That's good. That's back, by the way. I don't know, for some reason it was off, and now it's back on, so you can download it.
Oh, good. Okay.
And by the way, if you're listening outside the U.S., the list of books are different, and the books we recommend may not always be available internationally. So I apologize if that's the case, but don't worry. There's still plenty of other choices. Salem's Lot. Yeah, see, it says it's not available again. It comes and goes, I guess. Comes and goes.
Paul claimed that book was going to be the scariest one I've ever read.
And
see, I see. I don't know. I'm not scared yet.
Yet.
But again, he read it when he was a small child. So yeah.
Don't let Noah read it.
Exactly. I kept thinking, maybe that's.
So who wants to do our tip of the week? Is that from you, Travis?
I'll try. I'll give it a shot.
Fire when ready.
Should I do it in my sardonic Paul Thurrott tone?
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Now, actually, this one has probably been covered on your show quite extensively and certainly in Paul's book, Windows 8 Secrets. But I thought it bared the point to bring it up again is the search feature in the search and share feature in Windows 8. I think folks don't quite understand how it, you know, really what the impact is going to be, in the sense that you can search, you know, obviously with the charms over along the right hand side. But the thing is that not only can you search your whole OS, you know, similar to what Spotlight's been doing on OS 10 for some time, but you can actually search for content inside your applications without having to launch the application. So if you're looking for a particular movie or something like that, and you have a movie app installed, it'll show you results from that movie app. So you might not see too much of that in the RTM right now, but I thought I would give your listeners a head up that, you know, this sort of thing is going to be more possible as we developers start taking advantage of the what they call the search and share contracts. Same thing with the share. The share, a lot of folks kind of think of it as, oh, you know, this is a great way to share something really quick on Facebook and Twitter, but it can also share things between applications as well. So what you might, like a particular scenario might be that you're typing something in Word, let's say, and you want to translate it to another language. Well, you could share a highlighted text to a translator app, for instance, and then get the translated text. So kind of an interesting thing.
Well, that's interesting.
Yeah, yeah. Huh. So if you're using the RTM now and you're kind of not using the search contract or you're not using the search features, you might want to start kind of getting used to doing it that way and looking for things that way, because I think we're going to start to see some really cool scenarios that developers are going to take advantage of.
Cool. Search and share.
Nice. Yeah, and if you use it on a tablet or a touch device, you know, obviously swiping in from the side with your thumbs makes that kind of activity very, very easy to do. And I think it's kind of a new workflow for people. So it's not, we typically think in terms of apps. So it's like, okay, well, I need to drive to the app to do this, right, and then to the next app and do that. So yeah, I would encourage folks that are using Windows 8 now to start thinking maybe a little differently. And that would be my tip.
Good tip. I like it.
Good.
Do you think if you're going to buy a Windows 8 machine, even a desktop, that you should have touch?
That's really a great question.
Because what you just described, for instance, works best with touch.
Well, I wouldn't say it works best with touch. I would say that if you have touch, it works very well.
More intuitively.
Absolutely, because yeah, you can swipe. I mean, clearly, the charms and all those kinds of things work much better at your fingertips, I think. So I guess, yeah, in a sense, it does work better with touch. But if you have a desktop computer and, you know, I'm looking at my big Dell 26-inch, I think it's going to be very rare that I'm going to reach over and yeah, start wrapping things
right
around.
Right. Maybe that's why the Surface makes so much sense, really.
I think so. I think if I had to venture a guess, I think the notion of a laptop is going to be significantly different. The concept of what a laptop might be for right, someone is right, going to be significantly different once we start seeing these Surface devices.
Right. And our software pick of the week. You know, okay, so I know about this app. You know why?
Oh, do you really?
I get my Twitter stream all the time. I'm listening to Windows Weekly on Bringcast.
Yeah.
So tell us
right,
about this. Yeah.
So Bringcast is a buddy of mine, James, built Bringcast for Windows Phone, and he's a huge fan, by the way. So,
oh, good.
James, but I'm making you say hi to everybody.
Hi, James. Thank you all for right, Bringcast.
Yeah, it's a really cool app, and he's actually doing more stuff with it. So, you know, download the version he's got on Windows Phone right now and expect an update hopefully fairly soon. And I've seen some of the stuff he's working on, and it's really, really neat. If you're a big podcast listener, which I'm assuming you are, he's got some really great social features and things like that. And you're probably bringing up those tweets right now, right?
I am.
Yeah, and he tags, so it makes it really easy, like if you're listening to the show and you want to let people know, hey, I'm, you know, so much percent through particular show or whatever. And he's actually building more things in that regard. And it's some really, really neat stuff. So Bringcast is definitely one you're going to want to keep your eye on if you're a big podcast listener.
Apparently a lot of our listeners use Bringcast because I see this all the time. So it's really cool. It's really cool.
Yeah. Clark Zone right there. That's the developer, James
Clark. All right. ClarkZoneSoftware.com with an yeah, E. ClarkyZone. ClarkyZone. ClarkyZoneSoftware.com. Is he Italian? No, that's a joke. ClarkyZoneSoftware.com. He's from Bringcast.
He's English. He's from over the pond. Oh. He came and joined us.
I say. Well, guess what? We couldn't bring your server down, but we have brought the Bringcast server to its knees. So
did we really?
There you go. Yes.
Oh,
ClarkyZoneSoftware is dead. Thanks
I'm
to you.
I stayed up. I checked it.
Did yours sure stay up? We don't know yet.
I honestly have no idea how it stayed up, to be honest with you. That thing has got a Band-Aid on it and a rubber band.
Well, anyway, let's do it again. It's Windows.
WindowsDeveloperShow.com.
DeveloperShow. I didn't know they could have so many letters in a URL.
I know. That's probably why I didn't get
it. How do I type that? WindowsDeveloperShow.com. Everybody go there, bring it down.
You know, and for your listeners, you know, obviously it's called The Developer Show, but we welcome all guests. We actually have a fairly lighthearted show. We have a lot of enthusiast listeners that just like to hear developers talking about their latest apps.
Oh, I love it. I love it.
So it's not just, you know, talking about frameworks and code, and we have some fun too.
People rave about this show. So you must listen. WindowsDeveloperShow.com with Travis and his brother, Ryan.
Hey.
And now we continue on with the fabulous Windows Weekly program with our Enterprise Pick of the Week. Yes, once again, a chance for Mary Jo Foley to say her favorite word.
You said it on the intro today, which is awesome. Hadoop. People, it's Hadoop. It's just so much fun to say, right?
Hadoop. 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 It's alive.
It's alive. So yeah, this was great news this week because, you know, last year when Microsoft said they were working with Hortonworks on some Windows versions of Hadoop, they said they were going to do a Windows Azure version for the cloud, and they'd also do a Windows Server version. So the Windows Azure version's been out. It's been in preview. People are testing it. And the Windows Server version just disappeared. And every time you ask Microsoft, where is it? Nothing to say. Nothing more to say at this time.
Nothing to say here. Comment. Move along.
Yep. Luckily for us, somebody on the team posted a deck on SlideShare this week, and it shows that, yes, Windows Server Hadoop also is very much alive still. It's in private preview. That's why Microsoft won't talk about it. And the slides had some other interesting information, probably why Microsoft didn't want to have the slide deck out there, perhaps. But they also have something else we didn't know about. There's going to be a dedicated Hadoop cluster in the cloud, too. So there's going to be Hadoop on Azure. Then there's going to be this dedicated cluster in the cloud. And then there's also going to be the Windows Server. Now, the problem is we still don't have a date for when the Windows Server preview will be available publicly. And definitely we don't have a date for when it will be available in final form. So we're thinking maybe in the next few weeks, now that the slide deck has gone up, we're going to hear some more, and maybe that will be open to testers. Because I've had a lot of people ask me, where's the Windows Server version?
Right.
So now you know, it's not dead. It's still very much alive.
Not
and it's
dead
coming.
Yet.
Not yet dead.
Good. Yep. And your code name pick of the week.
Yeah, I need some chat room help on this one, too, to figure this one out. So it turns out the code name of TypeScript, which we talked about earlier on the show today, was Strada, S-T-R-A-D-A. And I cannot, for the life of me, figure out why the code name was Strada. My closest guess is one of the people who was very instrumental to building TypeScript, named Eric Gamma, who is still at Microsoft and works in Zurich for them, may have had something to do with the code name. And so I started searching Switzerland and Strada. And I guess there is, you know, they use Strada along the, hiking along the Strada, all different roads there, Strada. Other than that, I don't know. And so if anyone else has an educated guess, I'd be very interested.
I think this Fellini poster explains all.
Does it?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Anthony Quinn is La Strada.
That's it.
There, see, look at him. Look at him. He's
Anthony
manly.
Quinn, Anders Heilsberg, same person, separated at birth.
Or Eric's real name is Eric Lastrada. Ha-ha. Uh-huh. Uh-huh. I don't know.
Yeah, and so, you know, it's funny because I was looking back at code names that Heilsberg's been connected with. I really tried to figure this out. And, you know, the last name, code name I had he was connected with was Cool. And Cool was the code name for C# back in the day.
K-C or K-O-O-L?
C-O-O-L. Cool.
That's a crappy name. That's just like, hey, this is cool. This is cool. This is really cool. So he decided he wanted to do something more interesting in Strada, which means street in Italian. So, I don't know.
Yeah, if anyone can figure that out, we're all ears here.
That's the fun thing about Codename Bingo. You don't know. You know, why did they choose that name? Why did they choose that name? Paul Throd will be back next week as soon as he gets off the airplane from Colorado. But I am so glad we could have Travis Lowdermilk of the Windows Developer podcast here.
It was a dream come true, gentlemen.
Really?
Thank you.
We're really grateful to have you. Thank you, Travis. WindowsDeveloperShow.com or at T Lowdermilk, Lowdermilk on the Twitter. Of course, Mary Jo Foley can be found easily enough at allaboutmicrosoft.com. That's where she's about to file yet another story in moments. Sometimes she files stories in the middle of the show.
She was chatting with me and filing stories at the same
time.
An animal. How is that even possible?
She's an animal. Amazing. So it's so good to have you, Mary Jo, and to have you, Travis. We really appreciate it.
Yeah. Can I thank Mary Jo, too? Thank you, Mary Jo, for reaching out to me.
Thank
I appreciate
you guys.
We'll have you back.
Thanks for coming to the show.
You're great. We're really
thank you.
Wonderful. Yeah. Everybody in the chat room loved you, too. We do.
Hey, all right.
Yay, man. Yeah, let's get rid of that The Rock guy. I don't know. Hey, by the way, I wasn't here last week, and I felt terrible because, thanks, was it Iaz who filled in for me? Thank you, Iaz.
He did.
Because that was just the sixth anniversary of the show, and I wasn't here for that. So I feel terrible. But congratulations to Paul Theroux on 6 years, and here's to six more, with or without him. Yeah.
No,
just,
nice.
Just kidding. Just kidding. He'll be back, and he'll kill me. We do the show at 11 a.m. Pacific, if I'm here on time, on Thursdays. That's 2 p.m. Eastern time, 1800 UTC on twit.tv. You know, if you can't watch live, it's fine. We make audio and video versions available on demand after the fact via the interwebs at twit.tv/WW. But, you know, if you have Bringcast on your Windows phone or iTunes or the Zune Marketplace, you can always subscribe, and that way you won't miss an episode. It's my recommendation that you do that. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next Thursday on Windows Weekly. I got my invite. Microsoft invited me to the Windows launch.
Nice.
Shocked. I'm not used to
you
getting
invites.
You
can sell that on eBay.
I do believe it says non-transferable, Mary Jo. I don't think I'm allowed to pass that along.
I say you try to broadcast from your MacBook and see if they kick you out. I mean, why not?
Hey, Bomber, over here!
Exactly.
Wave!